Recognize that your mental health is so important. If you don't, then I promise you'll be so distorted. Stiffened by your thoughts, that's a mental rigor mortis. I'm on a hard mission and it won't be aborted. Assorted memories will seem to be your remedy, but in your darkest hour, form into your enemies. Trust your gut, judge people off their energy. Cut them off quick and fast, they are limiting your room to grow.
What's up, everyone? You're listening to the Expect Effect podcast, where the concept of self-care is our primary focus. Consider this an acknowledgement of feeling the opportunity to birth every great idea within you. This is your weekly dose of me time, and I'm your host. It's Jess Nakia. I'm really, really excited to be back, guys. I mean, in full effect, like episodes dropping every week, no holes, no missteps in organization, no dropping the ball on interviews. Just really, really excited to be back, to be creatively inspired and ready to get right into it. But before we do, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge you, to champion you, to applaud you, and to thank you. Because listen, this life thing is hard, that we know. But at least for the time that you're here, we believe that the processes of self-care and becoming the best version of yourself, well, these things don't have to be. So sit back, relax, and unwind as we together uncover ways to truly expect better, do better, and believe better. This month, for March, we're getting into the stages of self-development, and I hope you enjoyed last week's episode. Laugh now, cry later, do yourself a favor, and don't call it a comeback, okay? I was able to sit down with Kendra Crump, who gave me a hilarious interview, and I'm really, really excited for you to see who we have lined up for this month's segment, but Kendra is going to actually come back with us, so I'm excited to have her back, but we do have new guests lined up for that. So laugh now, cry later, do yourself a favor. Any comedians who are interested in being on this segment, go ahead and email me. You can find my contact information at theexpecteffectpod.com, but you can also just shoot an email to itsjustnakia@theexpecteffectpod.com, and we'll go ahead and get you taken care of. I've got some really exciting things I want to do with that segment. Also, want to go ahead and just give a big, big shout out to Forbes the Culture. As I stated on our last episode, I'm happy to be a member of that team, that community, and that family. Go ahead and get locked into them. Let's see what else. This Saturday, we've got our first blog post coming out for the first time since maybe November or December. Our first updated blog post with updated journal entry topics is going to be available this Saturday, and we're going to be releasing those blogs on a bi-monthly basis. Goodness, if I'm forgetting anything, forgive me. Be sure you visit theexpecteffectpod.com. There is not there is literally no other website like it, and I'm not just bragging, but I am bragging. Like, wow, what a great website it is. What a great website I've built, and you're really going to enjoy it and find value in it. You can go ahead and get locked in, submit direct inquiries to the show. You can listen to our show in real time. If you want to be a guest on the show, there's actually a form for you to submit and complete right there online. If you have any recommendations, you can drop them in. You're tied into our social media channels directly from that page. Live real-time mental health resources, as well as tailored vent sessions. If you're interested in life coaching, you can learn the differences between life coaching and therapy, and also get plugged in on our audio editing, voiceover services, and website development services. When I tell you this is a one-stop shop, I mean it. So visit theexpecteffectpod.com. Now let's get right into it. Before we can really talk stages of self-development, I first want to address self-awareness. And that's really what we're going to be talking about today, are factors of self-awareness and how you can cultivate factors of self-improvement once you fully understand what it means to be self-aware. So I want to start first with a definition. Self-improvement simply means enhancing your own value or worth. And if this doesn't sound familiar, becoming the best version of yourself. Now, we know this takes intentional work. Factors such as self-improvement, personal development, self-inquiry, and personal growth, these are lifelong ventures. John Duffy, clinical psychologist and author, states, in effect, self-awareness is the recognition of one's own emotional state at any given point in time. The argument suggests suggests that we are far too often wholly unaware of the emotional state we are currently in and the degree to which that state influences our behavior and thought processes. So, if we're able to adequately manage our various emotional states, then we're better able to manage other elements of our lives as well. Now, Amy McNoss, a marriage counselor and family therapist, adds on to this by saying, self-awareness is also the ability to look at your own words and actions from a perspective outside of yourself, to see yourself as others see you. So in this sense, we can see how self-awareness is a way of introspection that doesn't restrict the outside world, but rather brings it in for assessment against our own feelings and behaviors. It entails, as Katie Krimer, a licensed clinical social worker, describes, metacognition, which essentially says this is our ability to think about thinking, okay? And it implies the ability to recognize ourselves as we see ourselves, but also, and this is a reoccurring theme here, understanding how others may see us based on what we know about human behavior. So now that we have a few definitions in place, and I'm just going to run that one back, this is metacognition, right? Really, it all comes down to metacognition, true self-awareness, the ability to think about thinking, and implies the ability to recognize ourselves as we see ourselves, but also to understand how others may see us based on what we know about human behavior. So now that we have a few definitions in place, let's assess internal versus external self-awareness and how we're better able to cultivate self-improvement when we understand these placements. So the following findings were produced by Dr. Tasha Urich, and you can find a full copy of this article on hbr.org. That's H as in Harry, B as in bird, R as in rabbit.org. And we're also going to have some more information about that in the description of our show. So we've got show notes attached to every episode. And again, that blog post that I've already got ready to go for March 6th is going to have this information there as well. Moving on, internal self-awareness represents how clearly we see our own values, passions, aspirations, and how these things fit within our environment, our reactions, including thoughts, feelings, behavior, strengths, and weaknesses. We want to assess how these impact others and people around us. And research found, and again, this is by Dr. Tasha Urich. You're going to find this at hbr.org. Research suggests that internal self-awareness is associated with higher job and relationship satisfaction, personal and social control, and happiness, and that it is negatively related to factors such as anxiety, stress, and depression. Now, external self-awareness means understanding how other people view us in terms of those same factors listed above. Research found that people who knew how others see them are more skilled at showing factors such as empathy and taking on the perspective of others. For leaders who see themselves as their employees do, for example, their employees tend to have a better relationship with them and they feel more satisfied with them and see themselves as more effective in general. Now, before we begin to classify these behavioral types, in the realm of self-awareness, both external and internal, I want to take a moment to discuss the bundle theory of self, produced by David Hume, who was a Scottish Enlightenment philosopher, historian, economist, and essayist. Okay, he's extra dead, and is best known for his highly influential philosophical system of empiricism, skepticism, and naturalism. Those were a lot of isms, but David Hume, ancient, extra ancient, Scottish Enlightenment philosopher, historian, economist, and essayist. And we primarily know him in present day for his philosophical works on empiricism, skepticism, and naturalism. And he pointed out in the bundle theory of self that we tend to think we're the same person we were 3 years ago, whether we openly admit this or not. And although we have changed in many aspects, the same person appears, it's all an illusion, present as we were present then. And we start then thinking about which features can be changed, now pay attention to this part, without actually changing the underlying self. So Hume denies that there is a distinction between the various features of a person and the mysterious self that supposedly bears those features. He states that when we begin a process of introspection, we are never intimately conscious of anything but a particular perception. He states that man is simply a bundle or collection of different perceptions throughout our lives, which succeed feed one another in an inconceivable rapidity and are in a perpetual flux and movement. Additionally, Hume writes, it is plain that the course of our thinking and in the constant revolution of our ideas, our imagination runs easily from one idea to any other that resembles it, and it is this quality alone that is to fancy a sufficient bond and association. It is likewise evident that as the senses, in changing their objects, are necessitated to change them regularly and take them as they lie, contingent to each other, and imagination must by long custom acquire the same method of thinking and run along the parts of space and time in conceiving its objects. Long story short, these perceptions do not belong to anything according to Hume, nothing, but rather he compares the soul to commonwealth, which retains its identity not by virtue of some enduring core substance, but by being composed of many different, related, and yet constantly changing elements. The question of personal identity then becomes a matter of characterizing the loose cohesion of one's personal experience. Going back to internal versus external self-awareness, the problem with introspection isn't that it's ineffective, it's that most people are doing it wrong. Furthermore, self-awareness isn't one truth, it's a delicate balance of the two distinct, even competing viewpoints. And it's easy to assume that being a highly functioning person who's exceptionally self-aware internally or externally means that you're therefore automatically the same high level performing, going to perform in the same high level path as the other. So essentially, just because I'm internally self-aware does not mean that I'm externally self-aware. And just because I'm externally self-aware does not mean that I'm internally self-aware. So Dr. Urich's research found that there was no relationship between the two. And as a result, they identified four leadership archetypes, and I'm going to go ahead and share them with you today. So first, imagine a chart, like a rectangular chart, and going horizontally, we're going to examine in the first column low external self-awareness, and in the second column horizontally high external self-awareness. And we're only going to have those two columns horizontally. Now going vertically, we're going to have two more columns. Both are going to examine high internal self-awareness and low internal self-awareness. So when you're at a point of being low externally self-aware, but high internally self-aware, you're considered an introspector. You're clear on who you are, but you don't challenge your own views, nor do you search for blind spots by getting feedback from others. And this can harm your relationships and limit your success. This is to be low externally self-aware, but high internally self-aware. You're an introspector. Now, you can also be low externally self-aware and low internally self-aware by being a seeker. So you don't know yet who you are or what you stand for. You don't know how your teams or family or people around you see you. And as a result, you might feel stuck or frustrated with your performance in relationships. Now, one can be high externally self-aware and high internally self-aware and simply be defined as aware. You know who you are, what you want to accomplish, what you seek out, and what you value in others' opinions. This is where leaders and individuals in the leadership field typically begin to fully realize the true benefits of self-awareness. And now it is again possible to be high externally self-aware, but internally, your self-awareness is just low, and you're typically referred to as a pleaser. You're so focused on appearing a certain way to others that your facade tends to be overlooking what matters most. So over time, you tend to make choices that aren't in service of your own success and fulfillment. So where do you fall into this? Are you an introspector? Clear on who you are, but don't challenge your own views? Are you completely and totally aware? You know who you are, what you want, and what you want to accomplish. You're able to seek out and value the opinions of others. Are you a seeker? You don't know yet who you are or what you stand for or how the world views you. Or are you a pleaser, so focused on how the world views you that internally there's a lot of work that still needs to be done? Once you're able to adequately understand your place in this chart and you have a really good grasp of what self-awareness really entails, which is yet again, an ongoing process of continued work, then you know, okay, this involves all sides. And I know that if I'm going to really commit to this thing, I've got to be willing to examine all sides, both externally and internally. Now, once we've done this, how do we then cultivate areas of self-improvement? I'm so glad you asked. First, visualize it. Imagine the very best version of yourself. What do you see? What does living your best life look like? What does it seem like it's going to be like? Hell, what does it sound like? How do you feel? Is there a color associated with it? I mean, be super, super detailed in this visualization exercise. What do you do? What do you do well? Who's around you? What do you contribute to the world? And what is the world giving back to you? I want you to spend about 5 to 10 minutes doing that. And then when you finish that, you can do it like with your eyes closed, or you can try to write it out in real time, but I do want you to write it down, and I want you to be extra specific. What kind of car do you drive? What kind of model, like what all is going on? So just really be super, super detailed. What your house looks like, you can get detailed down to the decoration, but I want you to really visualize what the best version of you looks like and what the best version of life looks like. And also go ahead and factor yourself in. Determine, am I an introspector? Am I a seeker? Am I a pleaser? Or am I an aware person? And how can I, now that I know where I fall in this, improve so that I can be totally aware and then move forward with factors of self-improvement? Because once you know where you are, you know where you have to start. And even if you're a person who feels like you're completely aware, remember, these are continued processes. So even if you're a person who can say, I believe I'm in the structure of being aware and I know what the outside world thinks about me, there's still work to be done. And it was actually found that only 10 to 15% of the people they interviewed in Dr. Yurick's study were actually in the aware column. So you'll be surprised to find out you may not be as self-aware as you think. So go ahead and first try with a visualization exercise. Be very, very detailed. Once you've identified where you fall in the lines of internal and external self-awareness in terms of understanding and really embodying the characteristics that would either make you aware, a seeker, a pleaser, or an introspect. And then once you've done that, go ahead and move forward with a writing exercise. And this writing exercise simply asks you to entail what you think is going to be in your obituary. What do you think people are going to say about you at the end of your life? What would you want people to say about you? What contributions would you want to have made? And what would you want your legacy to look like? So once you map out what you want the world to look like in the living, imagine and evaluate what you would want people to say when you were gone. And I don't even mean that in a weird or morbid way. There really has to be an assessment of both past, present, and future when we're talking self-improvement and when we're talking increased self-awareness. There has to be a degree of inquiry. So you have to be interested in yourself. And to be interested in yourself wholeheartedly means really learning and assessing what your values are, what's going to make you happy, where are you most satisfied, who are you surrounded by, what is happening to you at work, do you need a new relationship, do you need a new environment, do you need a new thought process, a new routine. Making note of your moods, observing your habits, really becoming inquisitive about who you are, and classifying yourself is going to properly help you then propel factors of self-improvement. You can then become a real inspiration in terms of self-encouragement. Yeah, so you can become a real form of inspiration in terms of self-encouragement because you're further cultivating aspects and areas of trust with self. By running through these practices and getting to know yourself, you're also going to become more sound in your own thoughts and ideals. Ultimately, the road to true self-development, again, is an ongoing one, and it's hard. Don't be fooled just because at some point it seems like you're living your best life and everything is in place. Ultimately, there is always work to be done, and you can definitely benefit from visualization and writing exercises, as well as increased inquiry into self as you're practicing these things. Let your imagination run free and be sure to implement every practice you put in place. Once you've determined how you can improve, commit to that game plan and don't back down. Continue to ask yourself how you fit in the 4 self-awareness archetypes that that were described by Dr. Urich, and how you can relate to understanding the various versions of yourself that have presented themselves over time when we talk about the bundle of theory of self as presented by David Hume. So really, when we're looking at all of these aspects, we now know that self-improvement simply means embracing your own value or worth. And when you fully embrace your own value or worth, you don't understand it simply on an internal tip, but you understand it on an external tip. And once you've properly identified your archetype, you're then able to move forward with practices of practices of visualization and writing to go ahead and really get that out there. And I say writing loosely. You don't really have to sit down with a pen and a paper and a journal. I take notes all the time on my phone. If you have an iPad, I don't care how you do it, but it is very, very important that you see it in front of you and that you create that adequate game plan so that you can constantly be moving forward in stages of self-development and self-improvement. But remember, that starts with understanding internal versus external self-awareness, really cultivating those behaviors, doing the practices that matter, and knowing that the version of yourself that was existent 3 years ago, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, while it is not the same and it cannot be used as the benchmark, it is still applicable. It does still matter. It's worthy of assessment. Who you are in the present is worthy of assessment. And in visualizing what you want for your future and what you would want the world to say after you're gone, you're able to then assess, this is how I want to build from the present so that it can properly impact the future based on what I know of the past. So that is really in a nutshell, and I mean a small nutshell, because I've only been here like 20 minutes and we're talking big, big philosophies and ideas, and you're definitely free to do your own reading and divulge more. But what we're going to do is have detailed journal entry questions up on our blog page for this Saturday. We're also going to have more information just about the nature of the bundle of self theory, or the bundle theory of self, excuse me, so many words interchange here, as well as those four self-awareness archetypes and how you can fit, pretty much organize yourself into that mold. Right now, we're going to take a moment to step into full effect. And I'm really, really excited for this guest that we have coming on. You already know Laura Miller made that hookup and that connect so we could come to you and have this little discussion on self-awareness. Some questions that I'm going to be asking our guests are simply how they would define self-awareness and how they would rank their own levels of self-awareness and any tips they can give you for cultivating increased self-improvement and increased levels of self-awareness. And those are just a few examples. You already know I'm going to run it way, way deep and ask a whole lot more. So just sit tight, stay tuned, really excited. Next week, we're going to be diving into, and I'm just going to tell you right now, the episode is called Can't Go For That, discussing what it means to establish the appropriate boundaries now that we know what it takes to be fully self-aware and how to get started on that process to self-improvement as we work on and address our levels of self-awareness. So thank you guys so much. Sit back. We're coming back right after this and stepping into full effect. Man, y'all don't even know what I got in store. Y'all thought this was organized. Just wait.
So I go by Nahfa Nothin, Nahfa Nothin. I'm a recording artist, a creative in general, and I've got music that's available on all the streaming platforms. I'm working on some new music that should be coming, toward the end of spring, and yeah, that's me.
Man, and I'm really excited to have you here. Again, shout out to Laura Miller just for making the connect.
Laura Miller.
Man, and yeah, not for nothing.
She's dope.
Yes, yes. I'm just really excited to have this conversation. You guys don't even understand. We've been having technical difficulties since yesterday. So we've really been trying to get this going. So thank you, Noah, for hanging in here.
Thanks for having me.
I'm excited. I know this is going to be a dope convo. Today's discussion surrounds self-awareness. And to those of you who are still hanging in here listening after 20 minutes of that breakdown I did, ultimately, all I'm saying is that self-awareness is required as it's like the prerequisite to self-improvement. If you do not have an adequate understanding of both internal and external factors of self-awareness, you cannot properly move forward in terms of self-improvement or self-development. And ultimately, these practices can be completed by acts of visualization, writing, or other like techniques as you continue to explore yourself, understand who you are, and where you fit in the four self-awareness archetypes. Now, Noah, the four self-awareness archetypes are introspectors, people who are aware, people who are seekers, and then people who are people pleasers. So this chart essentially says that just because I'm externally high self-aware, that doesn't mean I'm internally high self-aware also. I could actually have a very high level of external self-awareness, but a very low level of internal self-awareness. So introspectors are clear on who they are, but don't challenge their own views. The people who are aware know who they are, what they want to accomplish, and what they seek and value in others' opinions. Seekers don't know who they are, what they stand for, or how their teams see them, but they do tend to have an understanding, or at least a starter understanding of their performance, but they're really just constantly looking because they haven't established their own thought process. And then pleasers are simply really focused on the external self-awareness portion and not the internal self-awareness portion. Based on these four archetypes, where would you rank yourself?
Oh, somewhere in the middle of all of it. I know that's not an answer. I'm gonna give you a better one though. I would definitely say that I'm somewhere in between being aware and being a seeker. And I think, and I'm gonna be more in the seeker space, because I'm literally always trying to learn something new, and that also reflects back on myself as well. So for me, it's really, I don't know, I think I'd say it's interesting just because, so I'm ADHD, and I've never been medicated for it. So what we dealt with is just like my parents trying to instill good habits and pushing mm-hmm. that awareness. I've sat down so many times, like, I don't know if you know, like, some of the fidgety nature that comes along with like those like focus issues and things like that.
110%. And I also think it's important you mentioned it just in a general tip of it's rarely properly diagnosed in the Black community. Or in minority communities, when you're suffering from ADD, ADHD, and like deficit disorders, you may be fidgety, high anxious, a high thinker. A lot of times for me, people assume I'm responding to them because I'm quick and efficient. And most of my response times are really anxiety based because I can't stand to have it looming over me.
Exactly. So I've recently too, because Clubhouse is incredibly new, met with a bunch of people on there, and they were describing what they kind of been calling it is more just like being neurodivergent. So it's like a whole grouping of all of the different kind of brain situations that are out there. They're like, okay, neurodivergent. I like that, right? Because it doesn't paint it as like a disorder as much as I'm just different, and that's fine. But so in listening to that and understanding other people who have some of the same, like, kind of, you know, struggles that I have, I've learned even more. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I have to take that in. Like, am I like that? And in what way am I like that? And I've like developed a thing from being in some of those conversations. So, you know, you go to like a carnival, and they've got the little game where you got the hammer and you hit the you slam the hammer down and the little whatever it is,
it
goes to the top and it hits the bell, right?
Whoever they are. Yeah, I'm with you.
Yeah, so that's how I describe certain things, because with neurodivergence, there's brain chemicals that everyone else has in a different level that I'm going to always have a lower level of. So
I see what you're
saying. There's certain activities that where, you know, and so that comes into like the outer self-awareness too, because there's certain activities where someone will invite me somewhere and I'll go, yeah, okay, I'll come to that. And I have all the intentions to do that, but then I don't actually do it. Mm-hmm. And because of, like you said, from that lack of understanding of not knowing that you're struggling with something, actually, it's like you're trying to figure out, why is this the case?
And then you're only comparing yourself to what you would consider normal, which kind of ties into Hume's view, which is that perceptions, we have of ourselves, don't actually belong to anything. So it just states that the soul is kind of like a commonwealth, and we retain our identity not by way of virtue or enduring core substance, but that we are in fact composed of many different related and yet constantly changing elements. And when you think about a mind that would work in terms of ADHD or ADD, that definitely, I think that thought process definitely comes into play. So I understand what you mean there.
Yeah, exactly. So, having those conversations and everything, it's like I came up with the, like, what I basically say is something's not ringing my bell. It doesn't mean that it doesn't mean that I don't want to do it. It's just right now it's not exciting enough to cause me to do it. It's like you're going to have to either come drag me off the couch or something, because it's not exciting enough. And it's not that, you know, hanging out with you isn't exciting. It's just that right here, right now, it's not giving me enough dopamine or serotonin or oxytocin to make me want to go ahead and do that thing. But it's great to have that understanding, because, you know, I have, like, over time felt really bad. It's like, oh yeah, you know what, you're kind of a jerk. Like, you know, you tell people something, and that's where that outer kind of understanding is, like, okay, so I realizing that I come across in this way, mm-hmm. based on, you know, it's like, oh, okay, well, yeah, I'm dealing with this situation, and it makes me come across a certain way, but not necessarily the case. But then do I spend as much time trying to prove to someone where I really am, or how my brain is functioning, or do I stop making it so important and try to just focus on bettering myself by those, you know, by getting that greater understanding? So yeah, like when I was a kid, I would literally be tearing up all of my furniture. Like, if a little piece of thread's hanging out, I'm tearing it up. And I tell my dad now, you know, from being an adult, you know, having a daughter of my own, I'm like, man, your patience, dude. Oh my god.
Because he would just sit. I'm just not. Kids are not for me. And I applaud every parent. Like, I applaud every parent. But I just.
Yeah,
I
seriously.
Know. Oh my goodness.
And not every parent has the patience. I mean, that's the other part about it. You know, we're mm-hmm. all people. We're all capable of making mistakes and stuff. Sure. I mean, he wasn't perfect. We've talked, you know, we're grown. We talk about it and everything. But it's like that one aspect for me of just, he would literally stop and go, son, what are your hands doing? Mm. And it caused that awareness of, like, yeah, it's literally operating in full autonomy over here. I gotta focus on it a little bit. What is my hand doing? Okay. But that was like years of that same exact interaction in that same way. So it was like, it was never jarring. It was always really mellow. Just, son, what are you doing? So now that voice is in my head, and it's like, oh, well, that helps out with the awareness of, like, that aspect of me. But then it's like, there's so many things about a person, about your own person, that you could find awareness of. That's why I'm like, I would categorize myself as a seeker in that sense.
I definitely love the take that you've given on it, because you've painted a perspective of, here's a person who did have, you know, at least enough structure at home that you had that careful, consistent guide, but also there was no definitive name, diagnosis, or treatment plan put on your ADHD. Just a lot of cultivating at home. In present day, for people who may be struggling to really identify what self-awareness is, maybe because they didn't have that kind of structure or any structure, or they did have that kind of structure, but life is just fucking complicated. What you know yesterday, you're not going to know tomorrow necessarily. So many of us may assume that we're notably self-aware when in fact we aren't. So what do you think fuels that misconception? misconception. I can say on my side, I think it has to do with willingness to know self. It sounds to me like you have actively worked to understand what many people have probably described to you in your life as unexplainable or incomparable. So like this isn't meant to be understood, but you've taken the path of saying, I need to understand myself. What do you think fuels this false idea that many of us have that we have suddenly mastered understanding ourselves, even though this is an ongoing process?
Yeah, I think, and I love that question too. I think that what it comes down to is, so I'll say this, when I finally took the time to like read the diagnosis of ADHD and what some of those things meant and all of that, I felt lost because I read so much, and what I felt like I read was like my personality. Mm. It's like, ooh, okay, so if all I am is this sequence of symptoms, then I don't know who the fuck I am. Also, I'm happy that you just dropped that F-bomb, but I wasn't sure if I can curse
on
your podcast.
Definitely. We mark every episode explicit content, and I know that there are self-care programs for the viewers that clean that up, but right here, this is not one, so
okay.
Don't forget to go when you leave if you're not fucking with it, but please, guys, it's all jokes aside. It's just open expression, but I really love what you say to say. I read myself on paper, and if I'm only being categorized as these things, then who am I? Like, who is me? Like,
exactly.
Who can I be? That's a powerful question.
Yeah, it was just so crazy. And again, like the group of people like that I've just been talking to, you know, they are like, yeah, they relate to that really like hard. Like, man, yeah, how do you really deal with that? And it's like, I think that in that moment, I think it's easy to focus on those things. It's probably really easier to focus on those things because they're being pointed out to you so often, right? It's like, these are complaints. These are things people are telling you you're not doing right. So it's like, well, now I'm reading all these things about a personality or about a condition or a different brain mapping, and I'm saying this is the only thing that there is to me. But I also think that it's a mixture of people don't like being vulnerable, and then people don't like that feeling of not knowing themselves, of being lost. Mm-hmm. But it's that second that you take to decide that maybe you don't know yourself all that well is like when you begin to know yourself. It's like, okay, I know that I like this, but why do I like this? Or I know that I do this, but why do I do that? I have a really good friend of mine that said something about that to me one day, that he just came to the understanding of, he realized that he knew all the things that he didn't like or that he wasn't with.
I gotcha.
But he never spent any time trying to think about the things that he did like. So it's like you feel like you know yourself based on your environment. It's like, oh yeah, well, I like fried chicken because I've been eating fried chicken my whole life. It's my favorite. Because it's good, right?
It's delicious.
But it's like, is it your favorite or have you never had duck?
Right. Is there any real avenue of comparison there? That's so huge to say. And most of us know what we don't like. Social media feels that easy. And you know
exactly
what you want to be like. But there is rarely an assessment of who am I? And you hit the nail on the head, because one of the questions I was going to ask is, how do you think fear plays into a lack of self-awareness? And I think, to your point, it's a matter of lack of control. If I am to read something and then suddenly learn I'm disconnected from myself, or hear something and suddenly learn I'm disconnected, I'm going to become abrasive because it's all I've known. And now,
yeah, exactly.
Right now, I'm not gonna change this thing, but it's gonna be easier. And I think this is how some people end up in the pleaser section, to just now be focused on what people want to see.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I definitely love your point there. What do you think for you are ways, aside from what you've already mentioned, that you're cultivating increased self-awareness in your own life, and especially now that, just hearing all the work you've done, what do you consider to be the most difficult part of it?
The The difficult part is, I think, with everything, like the practical application, right? Mm. So you get to all of that understanding, especially with neurodivergent. Like, so, okay, I practically, I mean, that's the thing too, like for ADHD, it's like I practically understand all of it. So then it's like, then the frustration is the, okay, so yeah, how do I actually control it? And I think from my perspective, it could be a little bit different, just because of the fact that, like, I've noticed for a long time that I didn't operate the same way as other people. So I've been questioning it for a long time, where there are like so many other people aren't questioning themselves whatsoever. They are who they are. That. They're content with it. Yeah, they're content with it, and it is what it is. So it's like I've always had to question. I've always had to challenge myself outside of anyone else's challenge. I've always had to. Like, okay, but what are you doing right now?
And I do just want to take a moment to say that's the biggest part, asking that question. You have got to want to know yourself. You have to want to. I can't make you. No matter how many ways we paint this or say these things, you have to want to know yourself. So thank you for addressing the underlying question. I didn't even think about going there in terms of our convo, but knowing yourself and wanting to know yourself is so huge. But yes, continue.
Yeah. I think that that's really, really it though. I mean, it's just, it's that part that's big. I mean, if you're going through life and it feels like everything is working, how likely are you to stop and question? It's like, what do I have to question myself for? I'm doing everything right. Everything right. that I want, I'm getting. I don't think I need to question anything. And that's just that perspective. I mean, not everyone's, you know, as much as I'd like to believe, not everyone's looking to find ways to better impact the world and help their communities. You know, it's just not the reality. There's always people who are doing their own thing. And if doing their own thing has been working for them, they're not questioning anything.
And I think it's really, really important that you brought that final point up of they're not questioning anything if they're not doing the work. And that's why the four archetypes are able to exist. We will constantly exist in different realms. There can be a moment of your life you're completely aware, events can take place, and before you know it, you're back to being an introspector, or suddenly you're a pleaser, or you're back to being a seeker, and there's nothing wrong with that. No matter what stage you're at, no matter what area you're in, as long as you are constantly questioning self, willing to explore self, and gain that understanding of internal and external self-awareness, then you are constantly on track to move forward in terms of self-development. But that's the foundation to doing any other work. I could talk about a million things, but if you do not have an understanding of who you are and where you stand in terms of internal and external self-awareness, you're not going to get anywhere. Noah, I wish I had the rest of the afternoon. I know we could talk about this a million different ways, and I say that to all of you to say it can be discussed a million different ways. The theory of self, the bundle theory of self that I presented, that's one theory of self. There are several theories. There's self in activity, self in belief. There are so many theories of self. The biggest thing is the fact that you must begin with a solid understanding of self before you go anywhere else. Noah, I do want to thank you so much. In closing, if you could give anybody just one tip on this journey as they're starting to try to uncover their layers, even especially to the experiences you can speak to as far as people with ADHD, and just let people know one more time where they can find you, where they can get locked in with your music, which you guys are going to love. I'll be listening to it. We've got some of your music already on the Expect Effect playlist, which you guys can find on our website and on YouTube. Just a closing question. What piece of advice would you give to those trying to get started on this journey, and let people know where they can find you?
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you for having me, too.
Man, you're going to come back. We got a good vibe. Yeah, you're definitely going to come back.
Honestly, because... I'm not going to kind of leave it with my own thought, because there's so many great voices within our community that have said so many great things. Nikki Giovanni, and this is actually not even one of her works. She was interviewed recently, and in that interview she said, if you can't contradict yourself, you can't grow. And I think that's what I would leave, because when she said it, it resonated, and I think it resonates with the conversation.
That's,
you know,
powerful.
Where that whole,
you can't contradict yourself, you can't lead. And that's so true. I can't tell you how many people get into this idea that they are right, that they know it, and it's easy to feel that way. There is comfortability in knowledge. There's comfortability in repetition. It's why people don't leave jobs, marriages, all kinds of shit. But
exactly.
You've got to be willing to challenge yourself. Noah, you have been amazing. Not for nothing. This interview was not for nothing. All right? Okay?
Exactly.
Real quick, just let the people know where they can find you. This has been really powerful, and I look forward to working with you again in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so I'm on Instagram. I'm more active on Instagram at Nahfa Nothin. I'm on Twitter at Nahfa Nothin as well. I'm trying to spend a little more time over there. So, yeah, and I'm on Facebook, everything, and on all the streaming platforms on Nahfa Nothin. Go fast. And my new project will be coming sometime this year, too. So, yeah, be looking alive for that.
Yeah, definitely. Look alive and get ready, man. Thank you guys so much for listening. This has been another week of expecting better, doing better, and believing better. I'm your host. It's just Nakia. I want to thank you again just for tuning in. We are going to be back right here next Wednesday for another round, your weekly dose of me time. Listen, next week's my birthday, actually next Saturday, so y'all get ready for whatever energy I'm going to bring to the show next Wednesday, and we will see you here later.